I would like to express my gratitude to the scientific committee. I'm happy to be here. And of course, for the brilliant introduction of me to Dr. Harchenko. So today I would like to talk, maybe I would don't want it to do it, but I will do it. So the topic is quite provocative, as you can see. Firstly, I just would like to add, as I'm a young surgical oncologist, and my specialty is HPV surgery, so I'm totally not the expert in the evidence-based medicine, and even I'm still not an expert in the surgical oncology. So, just to say a few words about the actuality of this topic, why we just decided to speak about this. Meantime, in our country, evidence-based medicine becomes like a new religion. So what I would like to say about this is that each doctor who feels himself available just to check the oncology guidelines on the ASCO or ESMO site, feel himself like an evidence-based medicine doctor, and he feel his approach like this. So today, I would like to say that it will be just a discussion with you. It's not my expert topic, so let's start from the history. Just a few words, just because why this versus will be in surgical oncology. Just to highlight the problem that the evidence-based medicine in surgery, it's much more complicated than in the clinical oncology. All of you can feel it, and just to say that the first successful surgical randomized control studies was published in the 1960s. It was 20 years after the RCT in the clinical oncology. Just to illustrate to you this, it's a little analysis of the Medline database that was made but the Solomon group, with colleagues. So as you can see, just 15% of the randomized clinical trials that was published during the huge period of years was about the surgical oncology. Most of them, most of the case reports was just still about the internal medicine. When I'm saying internal medicine, of course, I mean all the clinical oncology. Sure, okay, thank you. Thank you. And still, over 80% of all published surgical studies are still case reports and the single institution small service in surgical oncologists in the mean days. So, why it's happened? Because evidence-based practice has some limitations, it's just in my feelings. So, first of all, it relies on scope on concept of the evidence hierarchy, and it's really discussed topics, especially in, for example, our HPV community is like present time hierarchy of evidence. It's quite outdated, and all experts, experts all over the world try to implement the great system in the evidence base. As all of you know, the evidence-based medicine promotes the randomized control trials as the basic of it. And sure, the its inference evidence is widely appreciable. Well, here I would like to make you an, to give you some example. It was like, it's quite a joke, but still, just to illustrate the problem. So it was the study that was published about the parachute used to prevent death. The scientists decided to, sure, they decided to make it not because there is a big problem when we don't know should we use parachute when we are jumping or not. It mostly was because to try to extrapolate this problem to the surgery. They decided to make the search between the all the studies that was correlate with the parachute use, and they know sure that they use all of the quorum guidelines criteria. They excluded studies that they had no control group, and as you can expect, this strategy did not find any randomized control trial of the parachute. So what was the findings of this study? The first parachutes widely used to prevent death and injury, such a surprise. Still, it's linked to adverse effects with failure to open and iatrogenic injury. And as you can see, free fall studies do not show 100% mortality in the cohort where it was not a cohort, but it was cases where the parachute was not used. So the additional findings of this study that I would like to discuss with you was that no randomized clinical trials was undertaken for in this item, but still we appeal ourselves to use and to feel using of parachute is necessary between each jump for us. So, basis for parachute use is poorly observational, as you can see. And the problem is that the problems of efficacy may be due to healthy cohort effect. What does it mean? That in general, the general health status of the people who jump the parachute is mostly better than the people who are not jumping at all. So, but we are not. We cannot exclude this reason from this study just because it was not randomized as well. So, what we can see after this, that instance of randomized controlled trials for validation should come down to earth. Well, few principles of evidence-based care that I was already highlighted for you. It's hierarchy of the all evidence for present days. And the main what I want to say that evidence itself never tells you what to do. It's always evidence in context of patient values and preference. For me, it's the main point from this part of my presentation that we should keep in mind, and me as well. So the question is evidence better than experience? The question is still provocative. Now we should answer what this experience is. We should understand is a really multidisciplinary world, and its idea, its knowledge, it's sometimes its desire. So its source of knowledge contains what is known already. It's more than sensory perception, and sure, it's a dynamic process. As well as enrichment life, enjoyable for its own sake. More than that, I would like to say that all of us understand that without the experience, it's the main instrument of each of women and men who are trying to become an expert in each field. So, the contention is, experience regardless of level of evidence provides the true basis for resection in HPV surgery. I'm sorry, I'm talking about HPV surgeon because I'm an HPV surgeon. In fact, experience-based resection is the evaluative standard for both good and bad outcomes, as we all know, for all relevant HPV disease and conditions still. What is the proposal? Proposal is that resection in clinical practice has been established by experience. Experience-based resection is the essential dominant factor guiding surgical HPV management. Still, nowadays, we are guided by the experience. Well, just a quick premises, my premises overview. Efficacy of resection HPV surgery is based on cumulative experience always. Major technical modification of resection are experience-based, evidence-based resection is a tool to clarify and refine cumulative experience always. Evidence-based care has limitation. We all should understand that it's a really important point. And medical evidence is imperfect and applicability to the individual patient in experience dependent. So, our versus. What is the limitations of a randomized controlled studies for the evidence base in especially surgery? Is that usually, it's not only in surgery, it's in internal medicine also, that some of disease and the frequency of disease, sometimes it's too small and sometimes it's too big. And usually we're making our decision in our practice on the 3% of the patient's experience and not for the other 97. So it's the difficulties in the standardization of procedure It's the difficulty in the randomization. It's always not only in the surgical oncology, but in the oncology as well. And it's what is much more important to my mind, it's the strong patient and surgeon preference. We should understand that like only 30% from the patient who has to be signed to participate in the some of the randomized control trials, only 30% of them really signed and really participate in these trials. So our surgical implications of evidence management, it's valuable and if applied in context of patient values and preference and experience, as all we know, and it's our main aim in our life as a doctors, it's our patient values and preference really. Surgeons should critically evaluate clinical trial based on clinical experience and psychological rationality. Clinical trials, through essential to advancing patient care, tell us about the average patient. While a surgeon must apply the data to an individual by adding clear clinical experience. And as I already said, that evidence-based method hierarchy is outdated and new systems are needed, such as GRADE system. I will not stay on this because it's like other big lecture, but still just to say. So what should we do? It's the complexity and the complex of our decisions in making the our clinical decision. It should always include clinical experience, pathophysiological rationality, patient values and preference, result of clinical research, of course, and system features. Just to sum up all what I said here and now. So, experience is the primary base of rejection still. Experience provides the base for evidence-based inquiry, we all of that know. Both experience and evidence-based practice and distinct and titles with both strengths and weakness. So, rigorous statistical analysis of evidence coupled with all components of decision-making should grade data to develop clinical practice recommendation. Just to show you, for me it's an excellent recommendation that you can see of Professor Sakit, who was one of the founder of the evidence-based medicine. Just for me, I want to add that maybe each hour of our practical life and of our career, we should stay open-minded. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you so much, Aisha. Any questions from the auditory? No? Maybe some comments? Yeah.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Although I am a bit confused, can you give us an example of a study on a randomization basis in surgery?
Okay, I can give you the first.
And in surgery, alone with surgery. Not, for example, giving neoadjuvant versus...
I understood your question, thank you. That was a point of my presentation, that's really hard, but I will give you an example. It's the first randomized controlled trial in surgery, just only clear early surgery. It was the ulcers of gastric, it was surgery and no surgery.
Say it again?
It's ulcers of gastric, it was in 60s. So it was randomized and it was comparing the surgery and no surgery.
Yeah. Give me a second example.
So second example could be our cold trial. Yeah. I'm not surgeon. So D2 versus D3 lymph node dissection. No.
Well, it's a hard question because, you know, it's not the, it's all, it's in the both variants, it's surgery. It's still surgery. So it's not surgery.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yep, please, a question. I guess it will be easier just yet to say without mic.
Microphone is not used, unfortunately. I'm sorry, it's not. Нет, он не включен. Well, I'll allow myself a small comment on that, and I'll return all the way back to the very sources. Medicine of evidence is not only based on one approach of randomized trials. Randomization is used when you are supposed to compare two approaches with very small difference in efficacy. There are fabulous historical illustrations when phenomenon great success was used, when antibiotics were introduced into practice. It was in the past, penicillin turned out to be so efficient that randomization was not even needed. For a randomization to sound like the only accessible and possible method of efficacy and evidence, there are some methods of historic retrospective control, like implementation of radical mastectomy by Halstead when it was lymphadenectomy on top of removal of milk gland, and he obtained great results of treatment. It's the method of historic control, which is also quite good. Medicine of evidence assumes that there should be a sequence, a plethora of different approaches. If it's evidence, it doesn't mean that only a randomized approach should be there.
We'll start that I'm totally not opposite of this. I'm not criticizing the evidence-based medicine at all. And in the beginning of my presentation, I said that my presentation is absolutely not about evidence-based medicine. I'm totally agree with you, and I didn't feel that I make, you know, such underline that I feel that randomization is only one approach in the evidence-based medicine. So, thank you.
Possible. Thank you.
Yeah, if I can make a comment, since I have to talk about clinical research, I have to defend the evidence-based medicine. I think that the example that you have just made, it's true, there are some treatments that are very active and has really changed the way we treat patients. So in this case, of course, randomization is more difficult. But if we speak about medical oncology, and especially medical oncology in these days, it's very hard to have treatment like the one that you have just mentioned, so penicillin or other type of treatment. So in this case, to prove that these are treatment that works, that the patient tolerate, we need a correct evidence-based medicine, and the end of the pyramid is a randomized trial. So I'm a strongly supporter of evidence-based medicine.
I remember from the ancient history that Hippocrates never used randomized studies, but he proved so many things without randomized studies. But these are completely different thoughts of, I mean, comparing with what we are doing right now. In principle, historical data, it's not accepted by statistics. They have many pitfalls, so they never use historical controls if you want nowadays to prove something new. Correct? You agree?